beginnings, right? The Lord told him in October, this was the year of new beginnings. And then I told you last week on Tuesday morning, I woke up and the Lord says, behold, I'm doing a new thing. Or no, excuse me. Behold, I make all things new. That's what he said. Isaiah prophesied, I'm doing a new thing also. But God woke me up on a Tuesday morning and said, behold, I make all things new. I make all things new. So last week, we talked about Martin Crane's chair. For those of you that were here, you remember. We talked about, you know, Fraser Crane, that show. And Martin Crane is his dad, a retired police officer who hurt his hip and had to go live with his son. And what a trouble he had going through that process. And how many, there's the old chair. And Martin loved that chair. Martin loved that chair. He did not want to let that chair go because he was attached to it, because he was attached to it emotionally. It represented certain things to him. And so we talked about how we get emotionally attached to certain things and stuck in our life, but he wants to do a new thing. And then I told you how it all went down by the end of the series, that Martin's beloved chair had gotten destroyed. If you don't know the episode, you have to find it, but oil was spilled on it and fire came and they threw it out the window and it crashed at his feet. Chair's destroyed. It doesn't matter how things get destroyed in your life.
Come on.
Because God makes all things new.
Yes.
I am a walking miracle.
Come on.
I am, personally, me, Deena Lynn Smeltzer, I am a walking miracle. Y'all don't know that because you didn't see me walking around 20, 30 years ago. You don't know what a walking miracle I am.
Come on.
Man, borderline schizophrenic, narcissistic, bipolar, manic depressive, suicidal. How many more should I list? That was me. I can't be around people and I can't be alone. That's what they told me. I am a walking miracle.
Yes. Hallelujah.
And guess what else? We had a miracle in our house this weekend. We had a miracle in our house this weekend. Y'all should be having miracles in your house every day.
Come on.
Are you having trouble recognizing the miracle?
Yeah.
Sometimes we do. We have trouble recognizing the miracle because we're hanging on to that old chair. We had a miracle in our house this weekend. And we need to start hearing about these things that are happening. God's delivering people, setting people free.
Yeah.
You know, it's not always in the church service, but praise God when it is. It's not always in the church service. Sometimes it's just in something happens on your Friday night and it doesn't go the way it always went. It goes different this time.
Yeah.
Come on, it went different this time. Right? It went different this time.
It did go different.
God's all in about making things new. Things will go different this time. Things will go different this time.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes. God's all about making things new. Stop looking at the way it's always been. Stop looking. Now, would you step out in the aisle for me, please? And I'm only following the Holy Ghost because he shows me things. He showed me something this morning. When I first got up, and that happens a lot, when I first wake up, I see myself doing something, or I see someone else doing something. And so you just step out here. You're safe. You feel safe with me, right? The Lord just showed me how hungry in your heart you are for him. And he said, I'm filling you to overflowing, top of your head to the soles of your feet. You aren't going to be able to shut it off. And you know it's true. Look at that. There it is. Woo! Oh, my, 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 my. Oh, my goodness, my goodness, my goodness, my goodness. Oh, yes, yes, yes. Shh.
Yeah.
Just get your head out of the way.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You won't be able to shut it off, and you won't want to.
Glory
Oh, thank you, Jesus. Woo. See, when God makes all things new, He doesn't miss a thing. He doesn't miss a thing.
Come on.
Let's go to the Bible and look at Titus for a minute. Remember last week, those of you that were here, I told you there's two words for new in the New Testament, in the Greek language. There's two words. One means like new, like it never was. So that's in time, new in time. But then there's another word, new in quality. Yeah. New in quality. So here in Titus, it seems like the Lord's talking about both news. How cool is that? Titus, I'm going to go here, because I have some other translations I want to look at. Whew. Titus. I'm going to read it from the King James to start with. And this is Titus chapter 3, verse 5. Now, this letter is being written from Paul to Titus and exhorting him how to handle certain situations in the church, certain believers, how to encourage believers in different things that are happening. And he's been talking about some behavior, but now he says, "For we ourselves also were sometimes foolish." Okay? I can say I was sometimes foolish.
Yeah.
Disobedient. I could say I was disobedient. Where are we? Titus chapter 3, verse 3. Starting with verse 3, sorry, Titus chapter 3. "We also ourselves were sometimes foolish, disobedient, deceived." I can say I was deceived at one point in my life, right? I told you I'm a walking miracle. "Deceived, serving divers lusts and pleasures." King James says it funny, but you know what it means. Many lusts, different pleasures, fleshly pleasures. "Living in malice," or anger, "and envy, hateful, and hating one another." He's saying that's the condition of people.
Yeah.
Right? But then in verse 4, but then he says, "But after the kingdom and love of God our Savior toward man appeared," something changed.
Yeah.
Verse 5, "not by works." Not by works of righteousness. Righteousness, not by works of righteousness. That means it's God's way of doing and being right. So he's saying, he's qualifying. What happened isn't by getting it right. He's qualifying what he's going to tell us. "Not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy." Whose mercy?
His
mercy. "According to his mercy, he saved us."
Yes.
See, you got to get the pronouns right. "Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us." How did he save us? "By the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost." He did it all. He did it by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit. Now, regeneration is a different word. It actually refers, you see the word Genesis in there, Jenna. It's talking about new beginnings. Regeneration, bringing you back to new beginnings. Genesis is the book of beginnings. In other words, we're starting over. Regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit. Renewing is the word I talked about last week. Different quality. Better.
Yeah. Yeah.
So he did it. His mercy saved us through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit came on the scene just like he did in the beginning. God said, let there be light, and the Holy Spirit caused light to come. Yes. Let there be light. Yes. See, he did that over your life. If you've been born from above, then light came into you.
Yeah.
See? So you're new. You're not an old sinner saved by grace.
Come on.
No. Not if you've been reborn. Not if you've been regenerated. No. You're a new creature, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. It says, you're a new creature. Behold.
Yeah.
Behold.
Yeah.
The old is gone. Yeah. The new has come.
Yeah.
Right? Different quality. Different kind.
Yeah.
A creature that never existed before.
Yeah.
See, what happened is God had to turn things around because of what happened in the Garden of Eden.
Yeah.
What happened in the beginning. God's plan. Go to Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3, please. You know the account here that God had said, let us make man in our image. So he makes them male and female. He makes a garden for them. He puts them in the garden. He gives them some instructions, and because he wants to keep them safe. But isn't it cool? He made everything before he made man. And some people think that he made everything and then made man so man could take care of it, like he was God's slave. I want all this, and I'm going to put you here and make you work for it. But it's like I said before, it's like having a baby. When you're pregnant and you're going to have a baby, you're going to give birth to your child, you're making ready before the child is born. That's what God did. See, you were already in God's heart. So he made ready for you before you were born.
Yeah.
He did that with Adam and Eve. He made the earth, put the trees and the seeds and everything you needed before he put Adam on the planet. Made the planet the way it should be, then he put Adam on the planet. There, the nursery's ready, so to speak. Right? So we don't have to look at the verses there because you know that's what happened. But now let's look at chapter 3, verse 1. It says, now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, yea, has God said. Now, I study this so much, and it really will behoove us if we can change our mind on some things. New beginnings. See things. Remember last week we said we have to see how God sees, right? We want God's perspective on things. So it's unfortunate that sometimes translators use words that put pictures in your mind, and then from then on you think that's the way it is. And it actually says the word serpent, doesn't it? The serpent was more shrewd than any beast of the field. But in Hebrew, it actually said the shining one that came as a whisper. All that glitters is not gold, by the way. The shining one, the serpent. That changes your image a little bit, doesn't it? You used to see just a snake crawling around. But he said the shining one. Doesn't the Bible in the New Testament say that Satan comes as an angel of light? The shining one. Doesn't he come to you as an angel of light? He's not going to come with a red tail and a pitchfork and go, I'm the devil, don't talk to me. He's not going to do that. He comes to destroy your trust in God. That's what he did with Eve. He comes to sow a seed so you'll stop trusting God. That's what he did with Eve. Has God said? Has God said? See, but God had a plan. It's called regeneration. And renewing by the blood of Jesus Christ, by sending his own son to pay the price that I couldn't pay, to pay the price you couldn't pay. You see? Now, because of the fall in Genesis 3, because the shining one came with a whisper, lied to Eve, she believed it, ate what she shouldn't eat, she fell. What it means is she died in her heart towards God. That life that was breathed into her at the beginning when it says God breathed the breath of life, that life died. See, she didn't fall down dead right then. It took about 900 years, but she did die. And see, when we fall, something dies. And it happened to every one of us. Something died. But God, He's all about resurrection. He's all about new life. He's about picking you up and turning you around and making all things new. All things. All things. So Romans 8 talks about a deposit, if you will. Let's go there. Romans 8. Romans chapter 8. What I'm looking for is the where it talks about the first fruits of the Spirit. We've been regenerated and renewed by the Spirit. And Romans 8 talks about the first fruits of the Spirit. So we're going to read it. I think we're going to start with verse 1. Huh. Verse 1, Romans chapter 8 says, "There is no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit." In other words, there's no more condemnation for you who live in the Spirit. There's no more condemnation when you've been born of the Spirit, because now you live in the Spirit. I'll say that again. There's no more condemnation for you because you live in the Spirit, because you've been born of the Spirit. If you've been born of something, you live in it. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who live in the Spirit. And see, we all think that's something we do. No, it's something we are. It's something we be. You are new creations, right? You are new creations. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. You're a new creation. Let him be. That's what the original language says. You're a new creation. Let her be. Come on. There is no condemnation for the new creation. No condemnation for the new creation. Why? Because they live in the Spirit. They live in the Spirit. Spirit beings live in the Spirit. Verse 23. No, back up. Go to verse 18. I'm going to read it out of New Living, because there's a lot of King James words. New Living, verse 18. "Yet what we suffer now is nothing compared to the glory he will reveal to us later. For all creation is waiting eagerly for the future day when God will reveal who his children really are." King James said, "The earnest expectation of the creature waits for the manifestation of the sons of God." All creation is waiting eagerly for the future day when God will reveal who his children really are. You remember the account of Jesus being transfigured? Remember that? He takes Peter and John up to the mountain. And as he's there, standing with them, he transforms right before their eyes. He just transforms right before their eyes. How did he do that? The Spirit of God shone through his fleshly body. This is before he was crucified. This is before he was nailed on the cross. Before he was resurrected. This was Jesus after he had been baptized by the Holy Ghost. Okay? This is Jesus standing with his disciples, his two apostles, Peter and John, and he is transformed right before their eyes. It said he glowed so bright they could hardly look at him. The light that was in him emanated through every pore of his body. It says his clothes started to shine bright white. You turn on the light full blown that's on the inside of you and your clothes will glow too. And your face will glow too, just like Jesus. There's that much power on the inside of you that when it's turned on full power, you'll glow too. The whole creation is waiting for the sons of God to be revealed. The whole creation is waiting for the sons of God to shine. But as long as we think we're just sinners saved by grace, we're not going to shine. Until we know who we really are, until we know we're the new creations, we've been reborn, regenerated, renewed. There's nothing about us that is old. We said, out with the old, in with the new. Out with the old, in with the new. The Bible talks about putting on new clothes,
yes.
Right? Now, Romans, we got to go back to Romans chapter 8, because there's a verse we have to see. Verse 23. We know the whole creation is groaning, waiting. And it says, not only they, but ourselves also. So Paul's saying, it's not just the creation that's groaning. We're groaning within ourselves.
Amen.
We're groaning within ourselves. We have the first fruits of the Spirit. Even we ourselves groan, waiting for the adoption to wit the redemption of our bodies. Because the translators use adoption and it shouldn't have been used. Because adoption, there, in the Jewish culture, there was no such thing as adoption. So there's, it's saying here, we've been given the first fruits. The first fruits are our new spirits. But everything's going to be changed, not just our spirits. So for now, you have to believe by faith because you can't see anything different. Right? Jenna Lynn, I was thinking about this today. I don't know why, but are you afraid of spiders? Sometimes. But I was thinking this morning, if something fell, say a speck of whatever, and landed on you, you might, right? Thinking it's a spider because it felt like it. Just because it felt like it doesn't mean it was, right? That's happened to me. Something gets on you and all of a sudden you're like, oh! Because you think it felt a certain way. So you put a lot of stock in how it felt. Because just because something feels a certain way doesn't mean it's real. Right? So faith is the walk we have to believe God says we are who he says we are. We're new. Whether we look new or not. Whether we act new or not. Whether we feel new or not. That's what faith is all about. So it says that we have the first fruits of the Spirit. That means there's more coming. Because if there's first, then there's second and third and fourth, right?
Yeah, come on.
So if there's the first fruits and we already have it, there's more coming.
Yeah.
And we're waiting for it. And God said, I make all things new. Not some things, all things.
Yes.
And we talked last week about new creature. New Jerusalem, new earth, new heaven, right?
Yep.
Yeah. New life, new name, right? You know, the Bible's filled with people that got a new name. Why? Because they were made new. They were made new. You have a new name because you're made new. Revelation tells us we're going to be hearing our new name when we get there. Abraham got a new name. Sarah got a new name. In fact, Abraham is Abraham's new name. Did you know that Saul got a new name? You know, Saul really thought he was something, didn't he? Saul, he was very educated, right? He had a lot of power, a lot of influence. A lot of power and a lot of influence. People really respected him and followed him around. He had a lot of education. And he really thought he was something. His name was Saul. And then when he meets Jesus, his name gets changed to Paul. And it means little. It means little. That means he was brought to his knees. Yeah. We have to be humbled to receive the grace of God. Humbled to receive the grace of God. And that's what happened to even Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve go into hiding when they discover they're naked. They're exposed to sin, and they're immediately filled with shame. When we get exposed to sin, we're filled with shame. We feel it, right? It's like a dark hole on the inside. And it sends us into hiding. I'm not good enough. And so they went into hiding. But God came looking for them. And did you know even Eve got a name change? She got a name change. Because when she was first created, Adam said and called her woman. This is woman. He named her that. And then after God came and told them what would happen, he said to the enemy, the seed of the woman enemy will crush your head. So Adam renames her Eve, mother of all living. Mother of all living. Meaning life was going to come from her. The seed of a woman, Jesus Christ. The seed of a woman, Jesus Christ, would come from her and make all things new. There's nothing in your life that cannot be changed. Nothing in your life that you cannot be set free from. Because in reality, you've been set free from everything.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's the reality.
In reality, either God is true or he's not. If he says you're a new creature, then you're a new creature. Right? Well, but Pastor Deena, you just don't understand. I'm still having the same trouble with the same old thing. That's because you're not looking at who you really are. You're looking at the trouble. You're looking at the old thing. See, you start looking at who you really are, see who you really are, a new creature, made in the image and likeness of God, with the same power that raised Christ from the dead, living on the inside of you. See, you believe you got the same power that raised Christ from the dead living on the inside of you.
Yes.
It's not just for you to lay hands on the sick and see them recovered. It's so that you can recover.
Yeah.
I'm a miracle walking, as I told you before, because of that same power that raised me from the dead. We come in contact with people every day that need to be raised from the dead.
Yes.
That old life separated from Jesus Christ. Every day you see someone that is still dead in their sins. That doesn't mean their name's not written down, because the Bible says their name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. He wrote that long time ago. He put everybody's name in the book of life. They just need someone to tell them. They just need to see it. They just need to see it. Everyone's name is written in the Lamb's book of life. And when we see it and get in it, everything's changed. Everything's changed. See yourself in the book. See yourself in the book. You can't go along seeing yourself through the eyes of other people, what you've been told all your life, and even what you tell yourself, and even what well-meaning preachers have told you.
Come on.
Well, brother, you know, you're just going to have trouble till you get to the good old here by and by, because you got that flesh to deal with. You know, you're just not going to have victory in that area because you got that old flesh to deal with. And your rebuttal is?
Not so.
See, the enemy comes with those lies just like he did to Eve to get you to not trust God. God told you things. He did it with Jesus. Right? The heavens open up. The Spirit descends on Jesus. And there's a voice. Come on. What would you do if you heard a voice from heaven? We think we need a voice from heaven. Jesus got a voice from heaven, didn't he? And people heard it. And that voice says, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." He got the voice. He heard the voice. But guess what? The devil still came.
Yeah, come on.
You hearing a booming voice isn't going to stop the devil from coming. Because he came to Jesus after he heard the booming voice.
Yeah.
"This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Jesus had to take it for what it was. He knew he was his beloved Son, and he was pleased with him. Because when he went out into the wilderness, the first thing the devil says is, "If you are the Son of God." If you are the daughter of God, prove it. I mean, that's what he did to Jesus. Prove it. If you're the Son of God, prove it. Turn this stone to bread. Jump off the roof. Bow your knee to me. Why do we think it should be any different?
Yeah, come on.
Why do we think he'd lie to us any different? He'd say the same thing. If you're really the daughter of God, why are you having so much trouble? The same Holy Ghost that infused that life into Jesus, infuses that life into you and made you new. And that happened after Jesus died on the cross, went into hell, defeated the enemy, and rose from the grave. Then that same Holy Ghost was poured out on the believer.
Come on.
Same Holy Ghost. Not part. Holy Ghost. So there's a regeneration in Titus. Regeneration and renewing by what? The Holy Ghost. So you're new. New. Not worn out, used up. New clothes. Not old garments. Not old garments. Some of us are just letting our clothes talk to us. Old clothes, besides. Right? Because the feeling, we think it's a spider and it's not really a spider. Right? We feel it. We think it's real. Right?
Yeah.
Sometimes we see something. We think it's real. It's not real. The only thing that's real is what he says.
Yeah.
And he says you're new. He says you've been crucified with Christ.
Yeah. Come on.
So that means the old man that's acting like a spider that's not really there, that old man was crucified with Christ. So that old sinner was crucified with Christ. Right?
Yeah.
So now we're alive unto God. We're new.
Yeah.
So that changes the way we conduct ourselves. Yeah. Right?
Yeah.
Unless we think we're old sinners, then we're going to do what old sinners do. Right? Dogs bark. Fish swim. Believers believe.
Yeah. Come on.
And believers raise the dead. And believers cast out demons. And believers speak in new tongues. Yeah. Cast out any devils lately?
Almost.
That's what believers do. Right? Believers believe.
Amen.
believers believe.
Yes.
Believers believe what the Word says.
Yeah.
Not what you've been taught all your life.
Come on.
Not that you've gone too far. You've heard it. I've gone too far now. You've even told yourself, I've gone too far. That was a big mistake and it can't be fixed. So then you're saying the blood of Jesus can't handle it. You're saying the blood of Jesus isn't good enough for that situation. Is there anything the blood of Jesus cannot cleanse? Is there anything the blood of Jesus cannot give new life to?
No.
Oh my. No, he makes all things new. All things new. All things.
Yeah.
The Spirit of God. So the same scenario when the earth was without form and void in Genesis, in the book of beginnings. The earth was without form and void. Means it was chaotic. And it says the Spirit of God was hovering over the darkness. He's hovering over the darkness. And then God said something. And when he said something, that same Spirit, the life-giving, flowing Spirit, went to work.
Yeah.
See, and as soon as you said something, you believed in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, right? You believed in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, and you said with your mouth, Jesus is Lord. As soon as you did that, there went the power to make you new. Regeneration. Reborn. Man, how come we don't have any trouble believing in the miracle of life in a womb, right? I mean, you just think about it. All of a sudden you see Jenna Lynn. I got to use her because she's at that age and they're getting married. So, you know, it's more believable. Wouldn't be so believable if I used myself. So I'm using Jenna Lynn. So one day you see her. Could you stand up, please? I'm sorry, I'm picking on all my girls today, but that's all right. See, you see Jenna Lynn. One day, she walks in and she's got a little baby pooch right here, maybe. You know, like a little pooch. And we have no trouble figuring out how that happened. Sorry. I'm so sorry. But we have no trouble believing that, do we? That's a miracle.
Yeah.
A miracle that God designed. It's a miracle that a man and a woman could come together in this little thing, and this little thing could boom and psh, all of a sudden grow. Pew, pew, pew. All by the power of God, who did it because it's life that was infused. The life of God that causes that miracle. That same power, that same life, that same miracle happens in you when you come in contact with the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
He infuses his life on the inside of you. Woo! Woo! Woo!
Come on.
Why do we have any trouble believing that?
Come on.
Same miracle.
Yeah.
He's a life giver.
Yes, he is.
Woo! He's the life giver. Life of God in you. Life of God in you. Life of God in you. Same life. Same power that raised Christ from the dead lives in you.
Yes.
So when that old thing comes knocking on its door, you're like, really? Are you going to bother me with that again? Shut up.
That's right.
Dead old stinking thing talking to me. You did good. Shut up, right? You did good. Because you just lived in the Spirit. That's what we do. We're spirit beings. We just live in the Spirit.
Yeah.
We live in the Spirit. We live in the Spirit.
Come on.
You are not humans trying to be spiritual. You are not. You are spirit beings trying to live in humanity.
True.
But it's all different now.
True.
It's all different now. That's why things that give your head fits shouldn't give your head fits anymore. That's not to say the spider's not going to still land on your shoulder. But when it does, you just got to flick it off and then go, oh, it wasn't even there in the first place. Right? But man, sometimes we feel that when feelings come. We feel it. It hurts. And we think, it's real. It's not real. It's just a feeling. And feelings what? That's right. Feelings live for a moment, and the moment passes. Oh, Jesus. 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 Nothing should take us out. Nothing should take us out of duty. Nothing should take us out of service. Nothing should take us out of giving encouragement to one another. Nothing. Because we know who we are. We know who we are. You know who you are? I know the heaviness of believing the lie. And you become so convinced that it's real that you're not seeing the truth anymore. Fiery darts come. Right? The Bible talks about that. That we should have our shield to quench all the fiery darts. That's what it says. Doesn't it in Ephesians chapter 5, I believe, talks about the armor of God? And it says we have a shield, doesn't it? It's talking about the shield of faith. And of course, when Paul wrote that, he knows what shields look like because he saw the Roman soldiers carrying them all around, and that shield was bigger than he was. That's a shield. And he also knows that those people, those soldiers carried those shields, say that three times, and they oiled them. They oiled their shields to keep them in working order. Because if they had not oiled their shields, they would have cracked and the fiery darts would have got right through. So sometimes in our walk of faith, we perhaps have neglected to oil a certain part of the shield. And in my case, that happened to me a few years back. And I was just going along my merry way thinking everything was okay. But there must have been a crack in my shield that I didn't know about. And I really didn't have to go on a witch hunt, because you don't have to go on witch hunts. You just have to go to the Father. You just have to go to Jesus. And so there was a crack in my shield. And I don't even really know. Yes, I do. Never mind. Crack in the shield. And a fiery dart got in. A fiery dart got in. And I remember when it hit. And I was just like, whew. And I remember the feeling. Felt like shame. Like shame I hadn't felt in I don't know how many years, but that's how it felt. And I was like, whew, that hurts. But then I just thought, well, I just pluck out the fiery dart and I'm good to go. But I didn't know that it had left a wound that was smoldering. So I get being under the weight of feeling things. But because I kept feeling it, see, you can start petting it, feeling it. Oh, it hurts. Petting that, owie. Start petting it. Well, you just don't understand. You don't understand what I've been through. You don't understand what they did to me. You don't understand how bad it hurt. You don't understand. And so you're petting that thing. And now you really believe it's real because you're feeding it. And you think it's alive. But I'll never forget, my husband said, just because you feel it doesn't mean it's real. I know that sounds really simple. But I know it was the Holy Ghost talking to me. Just because you feel it doesn't mean it's real. Meaning, just because you're feeling shame doesn't mean you got anything to be ashamed of.
Come on.
Man, it just broke right off of me. It just broke right off of me. Just because you're feeling it doesn't mean it's real. The only thing that's real is what he says about us. New creatures in Christ who get their value from him. His precious blood was the price paid for us. What's more valuable than that? Right? What's more valuable than someone that's been bought by the blood of Jesus?
Yes.
Nothing. Yeah. So just because you feel it doesn't mean it's real. And regarding the things of God, just because you don't feel it doesn't mean it's not real. Wow. Just because you don't feel it doesn't mean it's not real. Right? Because
yeah.
This is a life of faith, spirit to spirit.
Yep.
God's a spirit. Yep. We're a spirit. I don't feel God all the time, do you? Do you?
Nope.
Do you feel God all the time? If I'm not feeling God, does it mean he left the room?
No.
Right?
Yeah.
And yet sometimes we feel him more than other times.
Yeah.
Right? But that's God's prerogative, right? Or is it? Isn't God always here? Doesn't he live in a believer? So the minute you walk in the room, isn't he present? Right? But you don't always feel him. And yet he's always real. And he's always here. We cannot be moved by how we feel.
Come on.
We cannot trust how we feel. We trust the Word of God. The Word of God says we're new creatures. The Word of God says we've been regenerated, made new, born from above. The Word of God says that. The Word of God says we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. That's not just a happy, fun saying that you put on your refrigerator. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Right? Because I'm new. I've been made new. I have the first fruit of the Spirit. That's my new spirit, changed in the image and likeness of him. And one day, right, one day I'll get a new body. Just think if it had been reversed and we got the new bodies first and didn't get the new spirit, and we'd make a mess of the first, second new body that he gave us. God does things decently in order. He made spirits new first. And his desire is that new life that's in us spreads across the earth.
Yes. Come on.
Spreads across the earth.
Yes.
That all the sons of God will be revealed. Whew. These are the things, these are the truths that equip us to walk out our everyday life. So when the feeling comes, when the family member says, when they do, when he does, they don't, whatever happens, and all of a sudden we're faced with the emotions that go along with the circumstance, well, then we can choose, wait a minute, yes, I'm having emotions around this situation, but I don't have to let my emotions tell me what to do, right? I don't have to subscribe to their interpretation of these events. I don't have to sum up everything just because I'm feeling a certain way. Because if I sum up everything based on how I'm feeling, I'm going to start to believe it. Instead, I'm going to say, this is just a feeling, and I'm not going to give my feeling that much power. That's why Pastor said this morning, there's a scripture we have about not forsaking ourselves, right? Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves. And yet there are those who forsake the assembling of themselves on a certain Sunday morning simply because they don't feel like it. Right? Do you know how many days I wouldn't be here if I did it because I don't feel like it? Shoot. I don't feel it. I had a rough day today. You don't understand. No, I don't. All I understand is you're a new creature, and you need to tell that thing to shut up. Yeah. And that might sound hard, but that's the reality. How else are we going to lay hands on the sick? How else are we going to raise the dead? How else? Because we know who we are, and we're not going to let those petty little things, and I'm not trying to minimize the issues in life, but we're not, those issues in life are all subject to change. Yeah. Yeah. Everything on the earth is temporal, temporary, subject to change. Yeah. So we either pull ourselves up by our bootstraps and say, you know what, I got work to do. I don't even know what it is today, but God told me to go there, so I'm going to go there, and I'm going to bring my supply, and he's going to equip me, and I'm going to be able to leave there and do something I never did before, because he makes all things new, and I'm a new creature in Christ. Yeah. Old things are passed away. All things are become new.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
All things are become new. Yeah. So we don't not do things based on how we feel, do
That's
we?
That's right.
And there's things we want to do based on how we feel, but we don't do them. We don't do them. Because he holds us steady to our course. He's our anchor, and we hang on to him, and he holds us steady. He holds us steady. Because sometimes the winds will blow.
Yeah.
Right? Man, sometimes it's like we're going to capsize here. I can feel it. But no, we just hang on. That's why Jesus could sleep in the back of the boat.
Right.
I mean, wasn't it rocking and rolling like this in a storm on that sea? And yet he's asleep? We should be able to sleep through those storms too, right?
Amen.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen.
That same power that raised Christ from the dead lives in you too. Yeah. The same power. The same power. Wow. Isn't that good news? It's good news. Dang, is right. Yeah. Now you know why you're here. Right?
Right?
Now you know why you're here.
Same.
Right?
<Yes. laughs>
You were believing a little bit of a lie, weren't you? A little bit of a lie just had you slightly off course,
right,
just a
right.
little bit.
It does happen.
But then you hear it truth, you go, oh, shoot. Right? Course adjustment.
Right.
Huh.
Right.
Okay, Pastor. I'm going to keep going if I.
Right, well, praise the Lord.